This week on WealthTrack, Poland Global Growth Fund's Damon Ficklin explains why his high-quality growth companies should continue to outperform the market in the years ahead.
Other elements that I think are important is, one, getting the underlying earnings growth right. If you look at our portfolios over history, they've been very persistent in delivering that double-digit growth profile, even during really challenging times.
The five-star gold-rated portfolio manager joins us this week on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
Funding provided by Morgan Le Fay Dreams Foundation, Clearbridge Investments, Royce Investment Partners, Matthews Asia, First Eagle Investment Management, and Strategus Asset Management.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. The shift from COVID lockdown to COVID reopening has been stunning. Depending upon the stage of reopening, economies around the world are rebounding. The International Monetary Fund has raised its forecast for world growth to 6% for 2021 and a still robust 4.4% for 2022, citing fiscal stimulus in a few large developed economies, mainly the U.S., and increased vaccinations worldwide. The market's response has been swift and dramatic, particularly in the U.S., where major market indices have continued to set new records since the market bottomed in March of 2020. And starting in the fourth quarter of 2020, there has been a major shift in leadership from growth to value, large cap to small cap, secular to cyclical. So what do you do if you are running a highly concentrated large cap growth fund? That is the challenge facing today's guest. Damon Ficklin is head of the large company growth team at Polen Capital. He is also lead portfolio manager of its global growth strategy, including the Polen Global Growth Fund, which he launched in 2015. Since inception, global growth has delivered 17% annualized returns, beating its index and peers by a hefty margin. The fund carries a five-star rating from Morningstar and a gold analyst rating for its institutional shares and silver for investor shares. Ficklin, who joined Polen Capital in 2003 as an analyst, eventually became co-portfolio manager of the firm's flagship focused growth strategy, having worked with founder David Polen until his death in 2012. Since this is Ficklin's first appearance on WealthTrack, I began with the basics. I asked him to describe Polen's high conviction, low turnover strategy of focusing on highest quality growth companies with margins of safety. What does that actually mean?
We're looking for companies with, you know, return on equity of 20% or greater, economically, better than average earnings growth, high and improving margins, true organic revenue growth, low levels of debt. So those are kind of like objective definitions, if you will, of quality. And then more subjectively, what we're looking for is businesses that are truly, sustainably, competitively advantaged. And so that's what we're trying to get down to, the essence of what we're looking for in our investment process.
And the margin of safety element, because you describe yourselves as growth investors with a value bent. So what are the margins of safety?
The margin of safety is in the sustainability, the durability, the advantages within the business. And maybe I can, you know, digress for a minute and just kind of talk a little bit about our philosophical roots to try to connect it, because the margin of safety concept was originally a value investing concept, right?
Benjamin Graham.
Popularized the margin of safety concept, and the original concept was very much about valuation, right? It was paying 50 cents on the dollar, and that differential between intrinsic value and the price was that margin of safety.
Right.
Well, and David Polen, who was the founder of Polen Capital, has since passed, but he designed our philosophy and process from studying Benjamin Graham, Warren Buffett, all the, you know, the value investing greats. But our application of that is into a growth universe. So to us, the margin of safety is less about buying a dollar for 50 cents and finding the safety in that disconnect, but it's buying a company that may be worth a dollar today, but with the confidence based on the strength, sustainability, the competitive advantages of this business that it will be worth $2, $3, $4 in the future. So that's really the margin of safety to us, is in the certainty around that growth profile over the long term. So really we invest across the growth spectrum. And I think this is also somewhat unique for a growth investor. So what we're trying to do at the high level or in aggregate is to construct portfolios that are growing earnings at a low to mid-teens rate with the expectation that that earnings growth rate will eventually drive the investment return, you know, provided you pay a fair price. If you hold a company for 5+ years, or sometimes 10 more years, but every company plays a slightly different role. So we might have, you know, a high growth company like an Adobe or an Alibaba at the right hand end of the spectrum, if you can imagine the spectrum. And then on the left hand, you might have a Accenture or an Abbott Labs that are not going to grow mid-teens, but we think they can sustainably deliver a low double-digit total shareholder return through good times and bad times. And they provide a lot of ballast, you know, when you're in an uncertain environment. And then we have companies all in between on that spectrum.
Another aspect to this is when you have a very focused strategy. It's concentrated. And so at, you know, any given time, in your portfolio has, what, 25 to 30 holdings, is that right?
Yes, that's correct.
And you mentioned David Polen, who founded the firm in 1989. And over the, you know, 30 some odd years, I think the firm has only owned about 150 names, which is really incredible, you know, over a several decade period. When you think of a concentrated portfolio, people consider that to be generally to be high risk. But that has not been your experience. And why is it that you don't think your portfolio has been high risk?
Certainly investing across the growth spectrum, you know, having an Accenture, an Abbott alongside an Adobe or Alibaba plays a role in that. Those companies, you know, tend to hold up well in tough times. Other elements that I think are important is, one, getting the underlying earnings growth right. If you look at our portfolios over history, they've been very persistent in delivering that double-digit growth profile, even during really challenging times. Then the final thing that I would add is just it's part of what we don't own as well. So we're not in leveraged finance. We're not in commodities or commoditized businesses. These are often the areas of the market that are most negatively affected when you get into a crisis.
You mentioned that there are some companies that you've held for very long periods of time. Can you give me an example of one that's in the global growth portfolio?
Absolutely. Many of them actually have been in the portfolio since day one. So the global strategy incepted a little over 6 years ago, and nearly half of the holdings actually have been in there since day one. But two that I'll bring to the surface here is Visa and MasterCard. And we've actually owned them nearly a decade, if you include the U.S. focused growth strategy in the conversation, so predating the launch of our global growth strategy. And we think they're very exemplary of what we're looking for. I mean, incredible growth businesses. It's really, really hard to replicate either of these businesses, as you know. And if you look at the world kind of ex-China, and I'm excluding China only because it's a little bit of a different animal from the payments point of view. But if you exclude China, it's despite this move towards credit, debit, digital forms of payment, which has been well in motion for a decade or more, we're still, you know, 70% check and cash and other forms of payment that are going to migrate to credit, debit, and digital. So we think there's a great growth profile over the long term. And needless to say, the margins on these businesses are astronomical as well.
Now there's a new twist in their area, and that's PayPal, right?
Yeah.
And that is also, is that a more recent holding of yours?
It is. We actually added that during 2020, so at about the mid part of the year, May, June timeframe, as we watched what was unfolding in the world and everything was being pushed online. Well, long term, Visa and MasterCard will benefit as things move online as well. They actually have greater share in the online world than they do in the offline world, if you can believe that. But PayPal is exclusively serving the online business, if you will.
Yes,
and
transactions.
And most specifically, even the mobile online business, which is the highest growth and most attractive part of the market, especially in a COVID-type environment. And so we added PayPal because we saw a tremendous step up that S-curve. You know, this company's already been kind of climbing the S-curve of digital adoption for a long while, but the environment really forced users to try the product and then to engage repetitively and kind of get comfortable. And so It was a big step up in new user acquisition and a very positive inflection in engagement. Both of those things made us very optimistic about the future for PayPal as well.
Are there other companies that you own that have really benefited as well from the acceleration of the digital, the transfer to digital?
Adobe is a great example. They're a leader in digital media and digital marketing. And, you know, if you didn't have a digital marketing plan on January of 2020, you figured out pretty quickly that I need to figure out how to engage with my customers. And
right.
So that was, again, an S-curve that Adobe was already climbing pre-pandemic, but really kind of accelerated. If you look at Microsoft, which is another big holding for us, you saw immediately very, very large Teams implementations, Microsoft Teams collaboration platform implementations. Also, their Azure, you know, their web infrastructure business. Businesses immediately realized the need to be in the cloud. And so that was benefiting. And you can really kind of go down the line, even Tencent, which we own in China, you know, which is a leader in basically everything, social media and engagement,
right,
entertainment and gaming. People had a lot more time to play games and connect online than in prior years. So many businesses, those are a few examples, but I'd say it was a benefit across many of our technology companies.
You know, you mentioned Tencent. Alibaba is another big holding of yours. China is, as you said earlier, kind of a different animal. And we've seen, you know, much more aggressive government intervention in the private sector. And specifically, I mean, Alibaba has really been under pressure from the Chinese government. So how do you figure that into your evaluation of that company's prospects and also Tencent's as well?
In the case of Alibaba, we actually took advantage of some of the near-term challenges they were going through to add to our already significant position. So right at the beginning of 2021, we increased our position in Alibaba, making it one of our most conviction-weighted positions.
Why do you have the confidence that it's not that the Chinese intervention in Alibaba is really going to hurt the business model and therefore its financial prospects?
I'd say first off, the business model is very sound, very straightforward, actually, right? It's not very complicated. It's at the end of the day, it's matching sellers with buyers. There's 800
right.
plus million people that wake up and choose to log on to one of their platforms, properties, and buy goods. And then for that very reason, there's tons and tons of merchants that they go there, they want to sell their good there because that's where the buyers are buying. And again, they're electing to. It's very open, and if it didn't work for them, they wouldn't go there. At
right.
the end of the day, also, Alibaba is taking a very modest cut, what you can call a take rate, or the revenues that they're reaping as a function of the gross merchandise value that's being transacted over their platforms. It's very modest. It's roughly 4%. If you look at a company like Amazon, that take rate could be as high as 15%. So we think they're actually doing a lot of good. And I think another very important point is we think they're aligned with the long-term interests of the Chinese government. So the Chinese government is really trying to move towards a more consumer-driven economy.
Right.
And so there's very few companies that are actually doing more to support that aim than Alibaba is. If you look at their new user acquisition over the past couple of years, 60 plus percent of those users are coming from tier 4, tier 5, you know, smaller cities in China. So they're quite literally bringing, you know, the broader Chinese marketplace into the modern economy.
You know, we mentioned the beneficiaries of kind of the, you know, the acceleration into digital transactions. Were there any companies in your portfolio that suffered from the pandemic experience?
Yeah, there were a few, you know, and I'd say if you depended upon, you know, brick and mortar stores having your doors open to sell your product, it was a challenging 2020 for any business.
Right.
And so we own Nike, we own Adidas, we own Starbucks, and in all of those businesses really had some bumps in the road, if you will.
They did.
But if you look at, for example, Nike or Adidas, they've been steadily moving towards a more direct model as well. So their, you know, their legacy is the predominance of their business is sold through a wholesale channel of retail partners. Right. But first they launch their own stores, then they have their own direct online business. In fact, that's where they would like things to go. It's a higher margin business. It's a direct relationship that they control digitally with the consumer. They can wrap in rewards and all sorts of engagement tools. And so the first order effect of the pandemic was not good, because all of a sudden 70% of your sales are coming through brick and mortar doors that are closed.
Right.
But the second order effect is actually positive, in that it's shifting or moving consumers to the channel that they would most prefer. And they're really taking direct ownership of that relationship, right? So we had modest positions, what I would call across consumer discretion, but there are some businesses that we think are very, very well positioned for the long term, and we would count Nike and Adidas in that camp. In fact,
what about Starbucks?
We think Starbucks has a bright future as well. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit of a different situation in the fact that you can't really sell coffee online. So
right.
At the end of the day, you still have to have somebody come to your store. But
yes.
Starbucks has invested tremendously in the assets, whether they be digital assets, rewards, or the capability to make that transaction as easy as possible, right? You can do mobile order and pay, order it online, go pick it up in a drive-thru or curbside, or just run into the store. So all of those things are removing as much of the friction as you can. But again, at the end of the day, it's a physical good, and you need to kind of go, somebody has to hand it to you.
Why are you still coming out and saying, you know what, compared to all of the other options that we've got as far as companies that we could own, we still want to be in this business?
I think one thing that's important to kind of bring back to the front is that we really are long-term investors. So every time we make an investment, we're thinking about the next 5+ years. We think Starbucks is very, very well positioned. We do think that there's a long-term opportunity for Starbucks, even though they're kind of wed to the brick and mortar format.
We mentioned the criteria that it takes to get into your portfolio. What does it take to get out of your portfolio? Can you give us a recent example of a company that you've sold that you decided that it just doesn't belong there anymore, and what the reasons are?
There are a few reasons that we might exit a position. You know, one of the most important, though I'd say not the most frequent, is if there's a real risk that's emerged, or the business is being challenged, it's really deteriorating. Again, not frequent, but very important reason. With a concentrated portfolio, you do not want to take any undue risk. And so if we really see that kind of a risk emerge, we're very quick to get out of the way. I'd say the more common reason would be that the business is either just not living up to our expectation, or we find something a little more compelling. So despite our low turnover, we are occasionally successful in finding something that we think's better than something we already own. And then finally, valuation. It's always a consideration. We're looking forward, trying to make sure we get that expected return that we're after. We do think long-term, so we're not apt to buy or sell or act or trim or add based on short-term movements in the stocks, but at times the valuations just get too stretched and you have to trim or sell. A recent example would be Oracle. We actually owned Oracle, a leader in database, the second largest company in the application space and software. Great company, very, very sticky products. I've heard the expression that it would be more preferable to do dental surgery without anesthetic than to rip your database out of your company and replace it with a new database.
So true. Yeah.
It's very, very hard to remove them or displace them. They've been going through a transition to the cloud, as many, many companies have been doing. But for your database and some of the core applications like ERP, it's a little bit of a slow journey. And so in short, we just felt that they weren't growing at the rate that we expected. And we felt that there were other opportunities that were more compelling.
Speaking of price, I mean, for the last decade, large cap growth has been the place to be. Is there a sense that the companies in your portfolio are fully valued or fairly valued? Are there any bargains out there?
I'd say, broadly speaking, the market has certainly become a little more richly valued. We've been through a tough time, and the earnings of the broader market certainly haven't supported some of the share price movements in the broader market.
Right.
That being said, when you look down into our portfolio, our companies really are delivering. So they're They're performing well from a returns perspective, but it's being driven by, for the greatest part, by the underlying earnings of the company. So we've seen a little bit of multiple expansion in our portfolio as well, but not nearly as dramatic as you've seen in the market. And the aggregate valuation of our portfolios are at the higher end of what we've seen historically, but not out of bounds of what's normal. So it is a little bit more challenging to find values or steals in this market, but they exist. And you know, one of the companies that we added about a year and a half ago and certainly performed well through the pandemic, but you might not have expected it up front, would have been Abbott Labs. Very steady, diversified healthcare company, and you know, typically grows in the low double digits. This is not a super fast growing business, but due to its ingenuity and innovativeness, they basically developed multiple COVID tests through 2020 and have built a nearly $8 billion run rate business in a very, very short period of time. So despite pressure on some of their medical technology businesses or some of their diagnostics businesses besides COVID, they've still managed to deliver a very good result in our position for growth going forward.
So something else that has happened, of course, in your area of expertise, which is large cap growth, is that growth, which has been in the market leadership position again for a decade, has now been eclipsed because we've got this global economic boom going on, and suddenly the laggards and the rejected sectors of the last 10 years, the cyclicals have come back really strongly. How much of a challenge is that, and what's your view of it?
Our view is that over time, earnings is going to drive the outcome. And so it's very normal to go through these cycles. As we look forward, we think this is more of a cyclical adjustment as opposed to a secular change in what's happening. If you look at all of the trends that were occurring pre-COVID, we've touched on a lot of them, right? The move from offline to online with companies like Nike or Adidas, the move towards digital forms of marketing, digital advertising with Alphabet and Facebook and the like, the move from offline to e-commerce, like all of those things are well in motion. And if anything, the pandemic accelerated those secular trends. So we think this is a short-term adjustment. And as we get back to quote-unquote normal in terms of that normal earnings, normal valuations on those earnings, we think growth is still going to win the day. And so that's how we kind of take in what's happening here.
So Damon Ficklin, one last question. If for our one investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, what would you recommend that we all own some of, again, in a diversified long-term portfolio?
You could really pick almost any of the 27 companies in our global growth portfolio, but I'm gonna mention Abbott Labs. I talked about it a little bit before. It's not at the highest end of the growth spectrum, but it's a 100-plus-year-old storied U.S. institution, very diversified. The management team is excellent. They've been great capital allocators. We're usually pretty skeptical about companies that are acquiring or buying growth, but they've done it very well. And it's diversified in and of itself, right? They're a leader in diagnostics, a leader in medical technology, a leader in adult and infant nutritionals, and then finally a leader in branded generic drugs. They're highly cash generative. The company's steady. It's delivered, double-digit earnings growth really through environments, and 2020 was another great example of how they've pulled through. Company set to grow earnings about 30% this year, given the boost from COVID sales, and believes, both management believes and we believe, they can grow at a double-digit rate after they kind of digest that. And I feel confident in sharing an investment idea that's a 100-plus-year-old institution that's delivered constantly over the years as well.
Thank you so much, Damon Ficklin, for being on WealthTrack for the first time. And I look forward to checking in with you at a later date. Thanks so much.
Great. Thank you.
At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is review your portfolio for some rebalancing opportunities. The recent rotation in market leadership from growth sectors like big U.S. tech companies to cyclical sectors, including financials and energy, has been stunning. Evidence is mounting that we are in the midst of a powerful global economic rebound from COVID, and that means that many formerly unloved cyclical businesses, travel and leisure, truckers, shippers, manufacturers, home builders that are dependent upon economic growth will continue to benefit. So review your holdings and make sure you have some exposure to these former laggards, which have become today's market leaders. The value of periodic rebalancing, even after a major market shift, has rarely been this obvious. Next week on WealthTrack, a rare interview with great value investor Stephen Romick. He'll share his contrarian views from the helm of his legendary FPA Crescent Fund. In this week's extra feature, Damon Ficklin discusses lessons learned from the COVID experience. You can find it on WealthTrack.com. Also, please keep following us on Facebook, Twitter, and our YouTube channel. Thank you for spending your valuable time with us. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a healthy, profitable, and a productive one.